Okay, I think we're going to go ahead and get started today. And I want to tell you good morning and thank everyone for coming today. My name is Michelle Anderson, and I'm the Senior Policy Advisor with Policy and Regulatory Affairs at TG. And if you didn't get a chance to get a handout, the session is available up in the around the TG conference area on TG Online, so feel free to access that later if you didn't get a chance before the session. Also want to mention, and you may have heard this already, but for today's evaluations, you have a blue evaluation sheet in your folder. And so as you go through your sessions today, be sure and fill out evaluations for each of the sessions you attend. And at the end of the last session that you attend, you can turn it in at that time. So at this time, I would like to introduce our speaker today. Our speaker for this session is Valerie Scherer. And Valerie is the Director of Enterprise Systems Management for the U.S. Department of Education. Valerie has worked in the federal student aid program since 1978. Her resume includes Manager of Student Loans for Huntington National Bank, Director of Operations for the Ohio Student Aid Commission, Consultant on the NSLDS project with Raytheon E-Systems Company, and has been with the Department of Education since 1999. She is currently responsible for the National Student Loan Data System and the Financial Partners Data Mart. And Valerie is a graduate of Ohio Dominican University. And the way we'll do the presentation today is Valerie will go through the presentation and we'll allow about 10 to 15 minutes at the end, if time is available, to take questions. And with that, I'd like to turn the presentation over to Valerie.
Thank you, Michelle. Our focus today with the NSLDS presentation is about enrollment. Enrollment is one of our most important features on NSLDS, and so we're going to talk to you today about our enrollment reporting policy and our perspective on it, the importance of enrollment reporting, our enhancements to the website, which include the reporting profile page. Going to talk to you about location reporting, which is something new that starts off with what you report on the COD record. We're going to talk about the enrollment submittal processes, the enhancements that we've made, and I'll tell you a few other things that we've enhanced on NSLDS, and I hope to give you some time so that you can ask me questions. We like to emphasize enrollment reporting because it is so central to a lot of the things that we do with NSLDS data. It is central to and critical to those who are servicing loans. It is critical to us at the Department of Education because it helps us examine and understand our portfolio based on students who are in school or who are expected to become in repayment. And it's an important because it protects students' rights on their loans. So it's virtually part of the whole life cycle of a student's loan. Once they get a loan, is understanding whether they should be in repayment or if they qualify for in-school deferment. And all of that starts with the proper reporting of enrollment data. So what we try to do in improving the tool on NSLDS is that we've made a number of enhancements to give you better means of reporting enrollment data. We want those tools to improve the accuracy and timeliness of the data. And we also gave the students some tools that will help us figure out where they're at and whether or not they should be in school and added to an appropriate school's roster. So again, we emphasize when we have an opportunity to talk to schools is that you as the school plays a central role in telling us about a student's enrollment. We want schools to, especially when they use an enrollment servicer, to add students who are new to your institutions to your enrollment rosters so that we can properly track your new students' enrollment on NSLDS. And again, it's about the accuracy and timeliness of your data. So now let's just look at some of the new fields we've added on NSLDS. And these new fields were added both in our batch format and in our online tools. We've added the address information, and if you're looking on our online update pages, you're going to see this little house icon. And that little house icon tells you that you can give us enrollment address information on the students. And address information is very helpful to schools, to lenders and servicers, and to the department as we try to locate students. We also added a feature called the term date. And this date is used by servicers to figure out, especially for those students that are on in-school deferments, what term are you currently certifying for that student so they can properly monitor when that student should be converted back to repayment. And another field that we've added, and that goes along with when you give us a graduation, we want to know what credential level that student graduated with. So the new credential level goes with the enrollment status of graduate, or G, but we also want to know credential level. And credential level is only necessary at this time when the student is graduating. NSLDS, next slide. NSLDS also has some new reports that I'm going to go over with later on in the slides that will be helpful for you to monitor your compliance with enrollment reporting. We have an online report that is updated every quarter, and we've also given you a new batch report that you can request, and we're going to talk about that in future slides. And in the next slide, we just wanted you to see all of the various information that we've published about the importance of enrollment reporting. That started last year with the DCL that talked about the importance and value of enrollment reporting. And then we have a number of electronic announcements and newsletters that will be helpful for you to gain a better understanding of the requirements for reporting enrollment data to NSLDS. So let's look at some of the new enrollment features. And one of that features starts off with by you telling us how you want to receive your data by looking at the enrollment profile page. And on this page, you're able to tell us what format you want your enrollment rosters received in, and to tell us which mailbox you want that information to go to. You only have this ability to update this data if you're not using a servicer. If you're using an enrollment servicer for enrollment, you won't have the ability to update this information. But if you're not using a servicer, you can tell us which of the formats that we offer. We offer the fixed width, which we've always had, but we've extended it to add the new fields. We now have what's called common separated value, and this is a perfect format if you've decided you want to use some of our online update features. You can use the CSV value, and it also works well with an Excel. And we've also now, after many schools have requested, we're offering XML as a means to report your enrollment data to us. So with the profile page, you're able to tell us what format you want to receive your enrollment rosters in. The EdExpress software has always had an SSCR module. We've taken that module out of the EdExpress tool. So it's not there anymore because we've replaced it with our new online updating tool, and I'm going to show you how that works later on in the slides. So our spreadsheet gives you an option if you've been using the SSCR software. Our spreadsheet upload is a great tool to replace that tool with. So now I'm going to talk to you about how you can handle multiple location reporting. And that's under our administration profile page. What NSLDS did when we set up our new reporting format is that we set up every school to report their enrollment roster at the location level. Well, we know that a number of schools like to have a central location when they have multiple locations to process their enrollment rosters. Sometimes it's just the headquarters, or it could be any location that you designate. So the way we established our enrollment administration profile was to first set all schools up as their own administrator, but then give you the ability to go in with the next screen and for you to identify which of your locations should handle your enrollment rosters. you will see that this particular school in our example has 10 locations, but they don't want to receive rosters at all of their locations. So what they can go in and do is at each one of those locations, identify which school they want to be their administrator. And in the next page, I'm showing you how this school decided to take their 10 schools and have three different administrators locations to be their campus, with the O having several campuses, and then the O5 is also administrator, and while O10 decided to do their location reporting themselves. So we wanted to make sure, because we are tracking enrollment at that location level, but we didn't want to inconvenience schools who had not done our locations, who had not done their enrollment reporting, to allow them to keep an administrator school set up. So if you had a location that had not signed up previously for any batch function, what NSLDS did was look at all of the locations for which we have enrollment data that's come from the COD record, because you're telling us in the COD record the physical location of students, and that's what we use for enrollment reporting. If that school had no batch functions, what we did was default the location to the lowest number that was closest to it. For example, in this location, in this example, the O2 campus had never done any batch reporting. So what we did was default that O2 location to branch OO. And so those students will appear on the OO roster. Also, in the enrollment reporting profile, we now want you to look at your enrollment reporting schedule. And we want you to have the ability to freely create your own schedule and request ad hoc rosters anytime you feel that you want to update your student enrollment. What we're showing you on the next slide is how we've set up your schedule. What we do is we take last year's schedule and we create a future schedule. So at the top, that is the future schedule. We also give you a space now that if you want to update the schedule and change any date on the schedule, you can. You can also write in or give us the purpose. And the purpose is not for us. The purpose is just for you or your school auditors to understand why you've scheduled rosters at a particular time. So what you can do is on the update page, you can add a reason for why you scheduled a roster, and this is really just for your convenience, it's not mandatory. You can give us any date that you want the roster to be changed to, and you can also delete a date. If we have too many rosters scheduled, you can use the delete column to delete a date for adding a roster. We wanted schools to understand that it is their choice of when and how they receive their rosters. If you have a school servicer for enrollment reporting, they're the ones that provide us with the dates for your rosters. But you also can add ad hoc rosters even if you have a school servicer. So we're showing in this next slide that this school requested an additional roster for the spring term. They wrote in spring term, but they meant spring term. And you can edit this field whenever you put a note in. But this just helps to know that you've requested a roster, what it was done for, and when you have scheduled it. So you can see your schedule in advance. We also, on the next slide, give you the ability, for example, you might have students that are a large number of students that are graduating, and you want to do a special roster, you can request a roster today and it will be in your mailbox the very next day. So anytime you want to do a special enrollment reporting because you have a special circumstances that you want to tell NSLDS about, simply request an ad hoc roster and we'll place that in your mailbox the very next day. Now we're going to talk about location reporting. And again, location reporting starts when you're with your disbursement record from the COD. We ask in the COD record that you tell us the physical location that the student is attending. This allows us to know actually where funds are being used. And as you add students that are entering your school, we ask you to not only tell us about them entering which your campus is, but tell us what location the student is located at. We have a number of students who have appeared on several locations, and we try to enhance our enrollment rosters so that schools can actually easily tell us that the students are at one location. And we only want you to tell us that the student attends two locations if that is in fact the student is attending two locations. So what we've done on both the batch reporting and on our online tool is we have a space now that you simply tell us which of your branch locations the student is attending. And that's the two-digit number at the end of the school code. Your primary school code is six-digit with a two-digit location. So we're asking that you keep us informed about the location. And it's very easy to update location because you just simply put the location in the block either by batch or by online. And what we're going to do, because a number of schools had concerns, today when NSLDS sees a change in location, we will put that the student has withdrew from that location and has now moved to another one of your locations. But there was a concern with schools that they didn't want those W's as withdrawals. Just because a student had changed their physical location, they didn't want to see a W on NSLDS because that was an indication that students were withdrawing from your school. So what NSLDS has done, and it will be in place in June, is we have a new a field that where instead of a W, we're using the word moved. And when you see moved, that simply means that the student has changed their location within a main campus. So anytime you have a student who's changed location after June, you're going to see the word moved, and that means he's changed his physical location in one of your campuses. So now I want to talk to you about one of the new features.
If you can hear me, looks like we need to recall in, and I believe that would be on your end.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Hello?
Okay. Okay, yes, we can now. We had a little interruption there where look, we were on enrollment spreadsheet submittal, and we just have to connect you back.
All right, then let's go to slide 31. I don't think that you've, I was basically telling you that you can use our submittal process that starts off, if you download your enrollment roster from SAIG using the CSV format, if you choose that, you can take that enrollment roster that we sent you, you can update that on a PC in your location, and then you can upload your roster directly into NSLDS by using our spreadsheet submittal process. So you would go, after you updated your submittal, your enrollment roster with your data, we can use log into NSLDS. We will browse to your PC or your server where you've located your files for enrollment update, and you can upload your data directly into NSLDS. We'll give you the option in that upload feature to tell us how you want us to return an error file to you, or whether or not the file has been successful. We asked you if you want to see your errors online, because you can fix them directly on the spreadsheet. We'll ask you what color you want your errors to be highlighted in, and how you want to view that data when we return it to you. So once you have located your file and you hit submit, then we allow you to go in and open up the file that you've submitted, and we'll show you how successful you have been in uploading that data. So on the next slide, we show you what a results file looks like. You have uploaded your data to NSLDS, and we are showing you which fields, which students errored out. And when you highlight over the area in yellow, that tells you the error message. You can fix that information directly on that spreadsheet, and then you can resubmit it to NSLDS directly again. So this is what we use as our tool to replace what was formerly in the EdExpress software. We think this gives you control and gives you more information about what data has been successfully loaded into NSLDS. We also want to tell you about some additional changes we made to the website that we think will benefit students, and that will also benefit your helping us track where students are located. We have given you now the ability to push students to another school's enrollment roster. We also have given you an option of seeing address history on students that will help you in default prevention and skip tracing, especially if you have Perkins portfolio or other campus space aid. We also are giving you reports or tools that will help you see how your enrollment reporting process is looking to NSLDS. So one of the things we found that we thought would be helpful to schools is that sometimes when students are graduating or when they have left your campus, you know that that student is enrolled at another school. And you want to make sure that school who has received loan from your school continues to receive their benefits and protections of being enrolled. So what we are allowing you to do with this enrollment push process is to tell us what school that student is now at. And you can simply go into NSLDS, into the enrollment tab, and put under the enrollment summary and push the enrollment push button. And when you do that, you're able to give us the school code for where that student is now attending. And this will allow NSLDS to take and put that student on that school's enrollment roster so their information can be verified and that student can be protected from entering repayment early, or can be given a deferment because they're now attending a new school. So we thought this would help schools as they try to prevent students from early entering repayment while they're still students. Another feature that we've given you is we've added all the new fields to the sort ability. We give you the ability to sort enrollment data. If you want to, for example, you want to only pull up your enrollment information for students at a certain location. You can use this new feature, put in that location code, and we will pull back only the enrollment data for students at that location. So any of the fields listed on this page, you can sort and receive your enrollment rosters, enrollment information by these sort features. We also have now added address history to NSLDS. We allow anybody who has had interest with a student, and that means you've either given aid to a student, we allow you to see all of the address information that we've collected from servicers, lenders and servicers in other schools. We also are giving you a feature to update that address information. Address information is very helpful to other schools that are working with students, and it's very helpful to lenders and servicers in contacting the students about their loan information. So by hitting the update button, you can simply give us the latest address and information you have for that student. And once you see that address is updated, you can see that information directly there. If you know an address is good because you have verified the student is receiving mail, we ask that you check the good box, because that helps others who are doing skip tracing or trying to locate students to know that this information is current and was good. We give an effective date so they'll know exactly when the effective date is. We also have a column that tells you the source, and that source can either be another school, it can actually be the student, or it can be information from one of the federal loan servicers. We want you to be very conscientious about your enrollment information. So we've given two new reports that help you monitor your certifications to make sure they're up to date and timely. So one of the reports that we're offering is the enrollment certification by quarter. And this is a report that's an online tool that you can see anytime by going to the enrollment tab under the enrollment profile, and you can view the information by quarter. And what we do on the next slide is display for you the last four quarters of the enrollment information that's been updated on NSLDS. We want you to see the trends for seeing how many students you've reported in full-time, half-time, and all the various enrollment statuses. And this just is an information tool to give you a trend on what you're reporting and the enrollment information NSLDS has tracked for your institution. It's very helpful if you have an enrollment servicer, because this just gives you a way to monitor how your enrollment data is looking to NSLDS and to those at the department. We also have given you a new batch report that you can go to the enrollment from our reports tab on NSLDS, and that's the school report for enrollment number 4, SCHER4, and that gives you a report that's going to show how recent and timely your certification information is on NSLDS. So if you look at the next slide, we're looking to measure how current your certifications are, and since the last time you reported that data to NSLDS. We just want you to be conscientious about the fact that we want timely enrollment data so that servicers and the department is able to accurately determine students' enrollment statuses. So these are just two tools that you can use to track enrollment information. We also wanted to bring the student into the enrollment tracking process. So we have a couple of things that we've done to make students more aware about their financial aid. So the students have access to all of their data by going to nslds.ed.gov. All the student needs is a PIN, which we have on our site. We can tell them how to get their PIN. But of course, if they follow the FAFSA, they already have a PIN. So by logging on to nslds.ed.gov, the student is able to see their entire loan history and grant history on NSLDS. We also are now giving students the ability to update their addresses and also tell us about their current enrollment so that we can make sure students are on the correct enrollment roster. We also give students the opportunity now to use the My Student Download button. And with this button, they're able to download their information in a machine-readable format directly into NSLDS. Directly into their computer, I'm sorry. So by hitting that blue button, they're going to get all of the information we have on them about their loan data and about their grant data. And we have a number of vendors that are building tools that will allow the student to import their data into those tools so it is more easily read. This My Student Download button is also going to be available for their FAFSA data starting next month. In addition to the My Student Download button, students also have the ability to update their addresses on NSLDS, and we encourage schools to encourage students to use this feature. The address icon can be found on the menu tab at the top, just simply says address, so we're not often sure that students understand that they can give us their addresses, so we encourage you to help us with that. But students can go into NSLDS and give us their address information right there online. We update it and we make it available to anybody who has an interest in that student. And an interest is because they've made a loan at some point to that student in the past, or they are a school associated with the student. So the student address appears on the NSLDS professional website, and you can see there that we tell you that the source of the information came directly from the student. So either that information came from our exit counseling tool, or it came from directly from the student by using that address icon. In addition, we wanted students to be involved in telling us when they have enrolled at a new school. So again, on our menu bar, we have what's called enrolled, and that is where a student has the opportunity to tell us where they're currently enrolled. And this will help us push students to a school's enrollment roster so that we can verify and get certified enrollment for that school so that lenders and servicers can use that information to properly give students deferments. We allow students to search for their school's code so they'll know which proper school code to put there. And we give them all of the school codes, and they have to identify what particular location that they are attending. Once they pick out their school, they tell us which school they're adding, and we will take that information again and add that student to that school's enrollment roster for verification. I want to tell you about a couple other enhancements that you might find. We have a new report that's available to you, and the new report, one of the new reports is the new borrower demographic report, and we also have enhanced our school portfolio report, and I just want to tell you about a few things we've done with aggregates. So on the borrower demographic report, with this report, you can see all of the address history we have for a student. We heard from schools that when they're trying to help do default prevention, or they're working with a default prevention a servicer, they need address history to help track down borrowers. So we've recreated a new report, and that's the school report, CHPR1, and that gives you all of the demographic information that NSLDS has collected from servicers, from the student, from exit counseling, or from your updates from the enrollment rosters. We've also made enhancements to the school portfolio report. From our annual conference, we heard from schools that schools were interested in understanding more about the students' deferment and forbearance histories on NSLDS. So what we do is give you the deferment and forbearance information directly on the portfolio report now. It gives you the most current repayment information, the most current deferment and forbearance information that we have regarding those students. And most importantly, we experienced a number of difficulties with our aggregate information in 2012. So we spent a lot of time this winter working on improving and fixing those issues we had with our aggregate calculations. We wanted to improve how we identify the underlying loans for consolidations because we were finding that we had duplicated and overstated the aggregate balances for a number of students. So we took a lot of time to take some analysis and take some of the data that we were getting feedback from our schools, from tickets that we received in our customer service area, and we think that we have fixed the majority of our aggregate problems. We continue, if you find issues, that you call our customer service number, because we take all of the information we receive from schools and we try to fix the problems that we have on NSLDS. So I just want to remind you again that our customer service number is that 800 number. That customer service, again, is for financial aid professionals. It's not for students. We want our students to call our 1-800-4-FED-AID number. We also have an email address for you when you want to contact us about email about any information on NSLDS or problems that you are having. And again, your professional website is the NSLDSFAP.ed.gov. So now, I'm open for questions.
And we've got a microphone up here to stand, and so that Valerie can see if you'd like to come up to the microphone and ask any questions. Well, Valerie, while we're waiting to see if someone has questions, I did have one thing, and it may be a little premature, so let us know, but Jeff Baker, I believe, in his presentation had indicated regarding the new 150% rule for subsidized loans. Can you give us a little sneak peek or little information on how that's going to work?
Yes. Unfortunately, we just finished our enhancements for enrollment, but because 150%, you're going to soon be hearing about new things we have to do on enrollment, because this requires a lot more tracking of students' information, including, you know, at first we only focused on the credential level at the time the student graduated. Now we have to have more information about program data. We're going to be collecting more information from the COD record about what you're telling COD about students, and we're going to use that information to build the enrollment rosters on NSLDS. So you're going to see information that you've reported about SIP credential level, and more information about the current enrollment term or length of program. All of that information will be collected in a CLD record, and it's going to be used to build the enrollment record, and you're going to have a lot more to report in enrollment in the future. So we're working right now to iron out what we're going to be collecting, and we will be enhancing the enrollment roster file to collect more data.
Well, thank you for the little preview on that, and we have a question coming up here.
Hi, good morning.
Good morning.
I have a curious question with NSLDS. Was there any major updates that happened this past fall with the system with the servicers? I'm doing my challenge at this time, and we're noticing the trend that the servicers, for example, we would update a student's enrollment saying they went full-time, and that same day would say the student graduated because previous enrollment wasn't done correctly. What we're noticing is the servicers are taking the first entry of the full-time expected grad date and making that the separation date and not looking at the second entry that is the graduation date that says the effective date or going off the certification date. And I've gone through my challenge, and I've noticed is it's a huge amount of students that it's all going, all the servicers are basing it off the expected grad date and not taking any initiated of the effective date. And I have called the NSLDS, and of course I was told that's something you need to work with the servicers, and I'm like, I'm a school, I don't have time to work out this, but.
Let me just ask this question. Did you report the information on the same day, or did you report it separately? Because
honestly,
I'm gonna tell
day.
You, on the same day.
Yeah, well, and yeah.
That's,
yeah.
Unfortunately, that's a problem for NSLDS. Because NSLDS, when you're reporting a graduation and then a cert date, we tried to cover this in our Dear Colleague letter, they need to be reported, unfortunately, on separate days. Because when we get 2 days in, two simultaneous reporting on the same date, since we're not able to distinguish programs yet, in the future that will change, we will use that graduation information. If you had reported them separate, it would go by the most, the effective date would be what we would have evaluated. That effective date of the graduation would have been in the past, and we would have used the most current enrollment information. So I believe you probably saw that it worked for some students, and other students, they were graduated. It's all in how we evaluate it, and we receive the same enrollment on the same date. It is a problem, and we tried to cover in the Dear Colleague to say, please report those on separate days so that we can make sure that they're evaluated separately by our NSLDS logic. So if you want to prevent the problem from happening before we start collecting SIP and credential level, just report on separate days, and then we evaluate by using the most, the effective date of that enrollment to say what's current on NSLDS.
And the other thing too, is I've noticed the trend is that and it's only with the servicers, somehow, something in September, I don't know if you had a big system update with NSLDS with the servicers. The other trend, I have a student in particular, I can't give details because of privacy issues. I have a student that we update enrollment, but somehow their enrollment is bouncing off another school on the servicer end, meaning that you could see for example, the student was full-time 3 different times with us, and somehow it's showing up on the other school as graduating on 3 times on a different school. And I have 2 students that fall into that. I brought it to the attention to the servicer, one of them going, you know, a good example would be Fed Loans was one of the servicers that we brought up to the attention. And they're like, oh, you shouldn't worry about the other school, just worry about yourself. And it's like, well, no. But our stuff is kind of being reported on that school. So doing the challenge from last year, I just
could you help me out could you send that? I would really like to see that, that whole situation. Could you just email me or call me?
Yeah, I can get your information.
Okay.
That's the problem. I'll send it to you because it's what was it? So it's just and it's not ours. Last year's challenge didn't have this year's issues in that terms, meaning that what we did last year in the double entry, it didn't affect anything of this. It's all of a sudden it looked like anything was updated in August and September. I don't know what was going in the back end. It just kind of like there's a glitch.
You're the first to tell me about this, and I wish I had known because I would think that our cohort default area would tell me, but on the challenges. But if you could just email me or call me, and we'll work on seeing what we can find out about that, because that sounds like a glitch, and we need to fix it.
I appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you.
We have about 2 more minutes. Does anyone else have any questions? Well, I've got 1 more for you, Valerie. And I was just curious, on the information you gave us where it is now going to be reported for deferment, forbearance, and repayment, does the repayment field happen to say what kind of repayment plan the person is in?
Yes. That was one of the requests that you had, and we added that.
Great.
We can only tell you about loans that are serviced by the department. So
okay.
If it's a Bell lender, we can't tell you.
Okay, well, that's very helpful. Well, we thank you so much for being with us today,
sure.
Valerie, and giving us all this good information.
All right, thank you.
Have a great day.